So this morning, a very simple question, and perhaps you have thought about this question before. Perhaps you think about it often. But the question is very simply, what is the point? Why are we here? Why are you here? I don't just mean why are you here on Sunday morning at church. You might say to learn about God, or you might say to worship, or you might say because a friend invited me. But I mean, why are we here on planet Earth? I think this would be a good segue into the series that I just told you we'll start next week. What's the point? There is a reason for you to be here. Now, many times we assume that each of us must have his or her own unique reason for being here. But the case I want to make today is that there is one overarching reason that every single one of us is here on earth. Now, the Presbyterians have a statement that says, in answer to that question, that says we are here to worship God and to enjoy him forever, okay? And I think that that's probably a good answer. That's sort of my way of expressing their particular answer. Go ahead and turn those down. If they're real bright like that, it blows the thing out here, and they're just going to see this glow on my face. But the answer that I want to give you, I think, is perhaps along the same vein, all right? What is the chief end of man is the question that the Presbyterians ask in the shorter Westminster Catechism. To worship God and to enjoy him forever. But see, I think you have to take a step back from that. You're here to decide whether or not you even want to be a part of God's kingdom. You're here to determine whether or not you even want to choose to believe in God. Now, I don't mean believe that he exists, okay? The scripture says that you and I are fools if we fail to believe in the existence of God. The scripture says that even the demons believe in the existence of God and they shudder, they tremble at the thought. But that doesn't mean that they believe in him, in the sense that they are invested in him, in the sense that they are choosing to follow him. Now, God has shown himself to us through his son. So I can make it even more specific than that. You're here to choose to believe in God or not, to invest your life in him or not. But more specifically, you're here to choose to believe in Jesus Christ or not. And when one chooses to put their faith in Jesus, once again, that's not just believing that Jesus exists. Until very recently, you encountered almost no one who would try to make the case that Jesus Christ, the historical figure, didn't exist. But now you have people that are so desperate that they're trying to erase the existence of Jesus Christ. Now, in all honesty, I could sit down and talk with you about whether or not Jesus is God. He's the Son of God. He's the second member of the Trinity and so forth. Those are propositions of faith. And I think that I could build a good case that Jesus Christ is who he said he was, the Son of God, right? One with the Father. However, you could reject that, okay? Here's the issue. You can't reject that Jesus exists, or you pretty much have to reject all of ancient history. There's more evidence for the existence of Jesus Christ than there is for the existence of Julius Caesar. So that's all foolishness. Now, this isn't an apologetic message, so I'm not going to try to convince you that Jesus exists. Jesus existed. In fact, I'm going to take a step further. Jesus Christ was and is the Son of God. But believing that in your head is not the same as believing in Jesus. When you believe in Jesus, you believe in who he is. And who he is the Lord. Now, there's a word that we use in church, but you really don't use outside of church. What is a Lord? Well, in the Middle Ages and before, they understood that very, very well. In a feudal system, when there were lords and, you know, there were those who gave their allegiance to a lord, and there were serfs. There was a breakdown of where people fit into that structure, and they understood that a lord was someone you gave your allegiance to, that you gave your loyalty to, not if they did what you wanted them to do, but you gave your absolute loyalty to them. You fought for them no matter what. They were your lord. And in the Roman world, when this was first used, that word lord was employed for the emperor of the Roman empire. And the emperor was called a lord. In fact, did you know this? The emperor was at times called the son of God. And a number of emperors believed that they were divine. This started with the Romans saying that an emperor became divine after he died. But eventually you had emperors who were trying to make the case that they were divine walking around on earth. So when Christians came along, they knew exactly what they were saying when they were saying that Jesus is Lord. They were saying that he is the one that we give our absolute, complete, and total allegiance to. He's the one that we follow, in other words. So the Bible word, and it's not just a Bible word, but in a church context, this might be where you have heard this word. But the Bible word for a follower, specifically a follower of Jesus, is a disciple. A disciple. Now, in the ancient world, you could be a disciple of a philosopher. You could be a disciple of a particular religious leader back then. There were disciples of various rabbis in Israel in Jesus' day. And prior to Jesus, there were disciples of Socrates and Plato and other philosophers. That meant that you followed that person around and you learned from them and you sought to become more like that teacher. Many of you know that I used to teach karate for many years. I taught martial arts. I have a black belt in Ishin Ryu karate, and so that was the style that I taught. And when someone in Okinawa, for example, studied under a particular master, that master became their lord. That wasn't just somebody that, you know, you went Tuesday and Thursday and learned a few karate moves from so you could defend yourself. This was a lifestyle for them. This was a lifestyle comparable to a religious lifestyle for these people. And they would follow that master. They would follow that karate teacher. And I think that this is more in line with what we need to think when it concerns Jesus. So back to my original question. What is the point? The point is, are you going to believe in God, more specifically, believe in Jesus, more specifically, are you going to follow Jesus or not? Now, you could say not, but the only way that you or I have any possibility of getting into the kingdom of heaven and living on in eternal bliss with God is to follow Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. That exclusive statement is offensive to many people, especially today. But Jesus was simply making a statement of fact. He wasn't trying to be exclusive in the sense that he was trying to shut people out of the kingdom. In fact, Jesus' accusation of the scribes and the Pharisees was that that's what they were trying to do. That they set up these heavy loads for people to bear to get into heaven, and they wouldn't carry them themselves. They had the key to the doorway to heaven, Jesus said, but they wouldn't unlock it for anybody. They just kept it in their pocket. Jesus is very inclusive. He wants everyone. Jesus invites every single person, no matter what their background, no matter what their history, no matter what their sins have been. Jesus invites everyone to come and to follow him. But you don't come on your terms. He accepts you just as you are. But he invites you to follow him so that you become more like Jesus. And the beautiful thing about all of us becoming more like Jesus is that we don't just become clones of one another. We can all be like Jesus, and Jesus is so magnificent and so grand that we won't be anything like one another. We're like the body of Christ, like the cells in your own body. You have cells in your body that are bone cells and blood cells and nerve cells, right? and they occupy different spaces in your body. They're in different members of your body, and all of those cells are a part of a member of the body that is accomplishing something to help you to continue to live and to thrive. And all of those cells are different. Even the ones that are, let's say, all bone cells, they have a similar structure, but they're different, right? But every single cell in your body shares one thing with every other cell in your body. Do you know what that is? Your DNA. All of the cells in your body contain the blueprint for your whole body, for your DNA. That's kind of like us as Christians. That's kind of like us as the body of Christ sitting here. Every one of us can follow Jesus. We can all become his students, his apprentices, his disciples. But that doesn't make us clones of one another. Honestly, it doesn't even make us a clone of Jesus. It makes us who we really are. It makes us, each one of us, who we were created to be. You were created to be someone unique, just like you have unique fingerprints, just like, you know, now they can scan the retina of your eye for security purposes. The retina of your eye is unique to you. Nobody alive today, nobody in all of history has ever had the exact fingerprint that you have, thumbprint that you have, the exact retinal print that you have. You are absolutely unique. But see, God is so magnificent and so broad and so grand that all of us can become like Christ and still maintain that uniqueness. But you will never be who you were intended to be on your own. You don't just go out and seek your purpose. You follow Jesus. And when you follow Jesus, you will find yourself. That's just amazing, okay? Jesus said that if we're going to become his followers, we need to deny ourselves, that is, who we think of ourselves, who the person I think I am apart from Jesus. I need to deny that self. I need to deny that prideful, self-centered life, that self-seeking life that I have. Deny myself. Take up my cross and follow him. And then he said, because if you seek to save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you lose your life, Jesus said, for my sake, wait a minute, then you will find it. So it's a paradox, isn't it? In order to find yourself, you're going to have to lose yourself. You need to stop seeking yourself, and you need to start seeking Christ. That's the point. That's the point to life. That's the point to all reality. Everything that has come into existence finds its focus in Jesus Christ because he is the Son of God. Do you know what Jesus' favorite title for himself was? It wasn't Son of God. Son of Man. Now, that points to a prophecy in Daniel that speaks of Messiah, but I also think that it points to the reality that Jesus is the perfect human being. Now, that's not all he is. He's the Son of God. He's divine. The way the church has formulated it is Jesus is one person, but he has two natures. He had a divine nature, or has a divine nature, and had a human nature. In fact, theologians would say he still maintains that human nature as part of what he is, even as the resurrected Christ. Okay? But Jesus is everything a human being is supposed to be. If you want to figure out what human beings are supposed to be collectively, you look at Jesus. If you want to figure out who you are and what you're supposed to be, you look at Jesus. So that means you start at some point in time with a willingness to follow Jesus. You surrender yourself as you are now, apart from God, as you are alone, struggling on your own to become whatever it is you think you should be. You give that up, and you choose to give your complete and total allegiance and loyalty to Jesus. You let him be your teacher in everything. You let him be the one that is over you, the Lord over your life. In fact, the fundamental confession that makes you a Christian, according to the Apostle Paul, is this one. It's three words. Do you know what those three words are? Jesus is Lord. The Bible says that if you believe in your heart that Jesus rose from the dead and you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you'll be saved. for whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So if you can, in all honesty, with all you are, if you can say Jesus is Lord, that's the first step. That's what gets you in to the school of Christ. But that's not the end. That's not the final step. Now you have a lifetime to follow Jesus and to become more like him, to prepare for eternity with God. Now, I'm going to give you some bad news. Everybody is not going to heaven. You go to a funeral, and we want everyone to be comforted in a funeral. In fact, as a minister, I was taught in seminary that my primary job as the officiant at a funeral is to comfort the mourners. But I can't give the mourners false comfort by just telling them that their loved one is automatically in heaven. If I'm not sure, then that funeral becomes a memorial for that person. And I talk about the person, and I try to help them to remember that person. But if that person doesn't know Jesus, they're probably never going to see them again. Not everybody is going to heaven. You can make sure that you are, but you don't go to heaven on your terms. Heaven is not going to be just your greatest imagination. Heaven is God's space. Heaven is where God is in absolute, total control. Now, one of the statements that I'm going to make to you when we get into this series next week, through the series, is that God is not exercising immediate control over all of the affairs of human beings right now, or you wouldn't have evil on the planet. God gives you the ability to take control of your life and to make decisions, and some of those decisions are not good, and some of them are good. And when people make some bad decisions and that sort of snowballs, then we find great evil is the result. Okay? But heaven means that God's going to be in absolute and total control all the time, everywhere. You've got to decide, and you have the opportunity right now to decide, if that's what you want. Do you want to live in a place where God is in absolute total control over you all the time? You get to prove that right now by confessing that Jesus is Lord and following him. If you say, yes, I want to go to heaven, and yes, I want to do that, but you don't follow Jesus, then you're contradicting yourself. If you say, yes, I want Jesus, yes, Jesus is Lord, yes, I want to go to heaven where God is in absolute and total control, but you walk out the door and you do things that you know are wrong, that you know that the Bible teaches are wrong, then you're contradicting yourself. You really don't want that. What you want is what you're doing. So this is you exercising your faith and exercising your will. Do you will to do God's will or not? Now, we're going to make mistakes all along the way. You don't just say, I'm going to become a Christian, I'm going to follow Jesus, and boom, everything is perfect and you never sin again. All right? But what I do is I have an advocate before the Father, Jesus, who said, the scripture says, will judge everyone. That Jesus is also going to be the advocate for everyone who comes to him. In other words, he's going to be the defense attorney as well as the judge. That's good news, isn't it? I won't get you to raise your hand. You can just kind of go like this if you've ever gone to court. Anybody? Yeah. Yeah, Pastor. A few times. What was it like to stand in front of that judge? Well, you know, if you had a good lawyer, you know, maybe you were kind of all cocky and you're like, you know, whatever, my lawyer's going to get me off. Okay. But, you know, most of us can't afford like this super ultra attorney or whatever. You know, we might have been just kind of trying to hope it would go away. And you stand before the judge and you're like, oh, what do I do? You know, maybe you were honest, maybe you were dishonest. I don't know. But it's a scary experience to stand in front of a judge. But what if the judge stepped from behind the judge's bar, stepped down from his high place and stood next to you. And now he is your defense attorney. That would be a pretty good deal, wouldn't it? Yeah. That's exactly what happens with Jesus. So that's how I know that even when I start following Jesus, when I make mistakes, he's going to be with me the whole way. And the one that is going to judge me is also my defense attorney. He's my advocate. So I'm going to be okay. But my duty, my job, my responsibility from the point I say Jesus is Lord on is to follow Jesus. Not to follow my ideas, but to follow Jesus, to do what Jesus says to do. Now, I don't just kind of have some like perfect cosmic connection in my head to Jesus. The way I'm going to know for sure what Jesus said and says and does is through the scripture. Amen? Specifically, the 66 books of the Christian canon of the Bible. Those books are inspired. The Word of God is inspired. That means it's God-breathed. It's not just the word of human beings. It is God speaking through some 39 different authors over a period of about 1,500 years and speaking to us. If I'm going to figure out what I'm supposed to do with my life and I'm going to follow Jesus, I've got to discover who Jesus is and what he's saying to me by getting into this word. Now, if you rarely crack one of these open and read it, then you don't know what you need to know to follow Jesus. You and I need to be in the Word of God every day. And I'm in the scripture every day. You say, well, of course you are. You're a pastor. You're supposed to be, right? Yeah, probably. But I can say this, even if I wasn't a pastor, I'd be in this word every day because I need that. I need God's direction. I need that strength. I need my ideas to be contradicted by his word. I need to be formed by that scripture. Now, I can focus it down even tighter for you because you might say, well, pastor, you know, I've tried to read the Bible before. I don't know where to start. Maybe you tried this year. Maybe you started at the beginning of the year, you just started at Genesis 1 and you started reading, and then you bogged down about the time you hit Leviticus or Numbers. I'm serious. I have the Bible. It's called the Word of Promise Bible. It's the New King James Version that's read by all of these actors. And I have that on all my devices. I've got it on this phone over here that's recording this for Facebook. I've got it on a little old iPod that I have that I connect to my radio in the truck or that I take out when I ride my bike. And what I like to do is I like to just put it on random and just hit it. Now, it doesn't go random from verse to verse. That would be chaotic, right? You could get some serious weird heresy going on if you know, it just went from verse to verse to verse, you know. It'd be like, and Judas committed suicide, or, you know, and Judas hanged himself. You know, there's a verse, and Judas hanged himself. And then the next verse, go thou and do likewise. No, no, no. It's a bad way to read scripture, man. But what it does is it goes through chapters. It'll go an entire chapter. Now, I either choose the New Testament or I choose the Old Testament, or I can choose all of my songs, which includes both the Old and New Testament of the Word of Promise, right? And so we will just go and it will just start reading. Well, most of the time I get something out of that. Now, you know, maybe you wouldn't expect a pastor to say this because I'm telling you that you need to read the Bible. You need to read the Word of God. You need to be in love with the Word of God, right? You need to listen to the Word of God. But there are parts of the Word of God that are just not all that interesting sometimes. So I got on my bike the other day and put my headphones in and put my little iPod in and clicked that random, and I started riding, right? And there was a song that came on. That was great. And then there was this chapter. I should have looked at where it was, okay? But it just kept reading all of these guys' names. And I was like, Lord, this is, I'm trying to ride my bike, and, you know, and it's just, it's driving me crazy. Like, you know, and it wasn't a genealogy either. It was just describing. And apparently these were like 150 guys from the tribe of Benjamin, because it included Saul, you know, was the first king in Israel, and he was a Benjamite. And it said, you know, but at the end it said, and they were 150 archers. I was like, yes, they were. And you said them all. Blah, right? Gracious, okay? You don't have to think that that's like the super spiritual thing for you to do, you know, to just really grind down and read the book of Numbers or something, okay? What I suggest people do is you start by reading the Gospels. I usually tell people to start in the Gospel of John, right? And then back up and read Matthew, or back up and read Luke. In fact, you could go John, then Luke, then Acts. Now, why would I say that? Because Luke wrote both Luke and Acts as part one and part two of his book. Part one was Jesus and what happened on earth until he rose from the dead. Part two was what happened when the Holy Spirit got a hold of Jesus' followers and sent the gospel into all of the world, right? But when you take the next step beyond saying, I want to be a disciple and follow Jesus, then Jesus calls you to become a disciple maker. The last command that Jesus gave his disciples before he left the planet, would you say that the last command that a general would give his army would be important? Yeah? Okay, we call this the Great Commission. And that's what I've had my Bible open to the entire time. Now, this is the Great Commission is contained in Matthew 28, 18 through 20. It's the last 18, 19, 20, three verses in Matthew. And it says this, Jesus is on a mountain somewhere in Galilee, and he's speaking to his disciples. And he says, all power and authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Wow. Have you considered what that means? My old pastor, Pastor Jackson, preached a sermon on this one time, and he said this. He said, "That you know what that means? When Jesus said, all power and all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth, do you know what that means? Jesus is saying, I can do whatever I please. I can do anything I want to do. And what did Jesus choose to do? He said, therefore, go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I have commanded you, and I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. Your responsibility, once you have decided that the point of your life is going to be the point that God designed it for, which is to follow Jesus, your very next responsibility, once you start following Jesus, is to call other people to follow along with you, to make disciples. So my first question to you, what's the point? Why are you here? Could be answered in this way. The point is to become a disciple of Jesus and to make other disciples. You're going to do that out of your unique gifts and your unique personality. But that is the point for every single one of us.